Hi everyone, my name is Kent, and in this video I'll describe the machining of the parts of a 2D or XYA camera stage. I use this camera stage in my plant imaging and phenotyping systems, and its purpose is to move a camera above a tray, scanning all the plants in the tray. Unfortunately, I don't have much video from the assembly nor the operation of the camera stage. When I was building the camera stage, I was in a hurry, and either I didn't take any video or I've since lost it. I'm in the process of redesigning the camera stage, and before getting too far along, I wanted to have this design documented and a video made before moving on to the next one. If you have any questions, please let me know. Otherwise, thank you for watching, and let's get started. The mechanism is contained within a box built from aluminum extrusions and cover panels. The mechanism moves this camera along two axes. Two motors are used to drive those axes, and cable carriers carry the wires to the camera and to the motor. Inductive sensors with steel targets are used for homing. Everything is attached to two base plates here and here, which then screw into the aluminum extrusions. A stepper motor controller from Anaheim Automation is used to drive the two stepper motors. This connects to the computer by USB and generates all the pulses necessary to control these integrated stepper motors. These motors have drives built in. This is the controller for the drives. A grommet is used to protect the wires as they come into this enclosure. All the wires have disconnects to allow this module to be separated from the rest of the machine. The parts that we'll make include the base plates, all of these moving plates, the NEMA plates, the camera plates, all the cable track attachment plates, these offset blocks, supports for pulleys. Most of these parts, at least the smaller parts, will be nested together and cut from a single piece of material attached to a fixture plate. The base plates will also be attached to a fixture plate, but machined individually. This big chunk of aluminum will become our fixture plate. This corner is cleaned up for a point of reference. I want to be able to flip this plate over, so I finished drilling the holes through at the drill press and then use those holes as references for counterboring the backside. Now I'm cleaning up the edges of the plate, and this is a pretty large plate for the PM25 without a head extension, so only three of the edges are accessible. Most of the pieces will be nested into this one piece of stock. It's a quarter inch and it's been faced down to 10 millimeters. A lot of drilling is necessary, and some holes are with really small bits. Many of the holes then need to be counterbored because parts will rest on top of these plates and the screw head would otherwise interfere.
This will become one of the two NEMA 17 motor support plates. The camera attaches this part, and this hole is where the Ethernet and power cables go through. Now that all the holes have been made, the parts are contoured and they're held together to the remaining stock by tabs. This piece will become one of the two base plates. Feet hold to the rescue. This hole will receive a grommet. All the wires to the imaging module go through this hole. Many of the parts will be mounted on edge, so holes need to be drilled and tapped, and that face made perpendicular to the side. I messed this part up, but I didn't want to scrap this part until testing the idea. So I filled the area that I messed up with JB Weld and then milled it flat. This piece of steel will become the two targets for the homing sensors. The inductive sensors have a greater detecting range if using steel as a target. And even with steel, it's only about 0.75 millimeter of detecting range. Oops, well, at least it was only the finishing pass. These two pieces will become the two offset blocks for the motion controller. I made a simple design on the sides, and the eight sides gave me a chance to try some different finishing and roughing techniques. With the final strategy, after tumbling, the machining marks were pretty much invisible. The next few parts are supports for the cable tracks. Now all the parts are machined, and for finishing the smaller parts, I use a vibratory tumbler. Just add media, the parts, water, and a couple drops of dish soap. Any tapped hole should be plugged with a screw, otherwise junk gets down into the threads. After 12 hours, the tumbler has done a great job on the finish, and this is the part that I was talking about earlier with the different roughing and finishing strategies. And that last strategy, you can't tell the machining marks after the part's gone through the tumbler. Somehow I forgot to record, or I lost most of the video of the assembly. This is the little bit of video that I do have. I wanted to try to hide as much of the hardware inside the box as I could, so I use internal corner clamps, but they don't pull the aluminum extrusions tight. So I use these clamps to pull the extrusions tight before tightening the brackets. These are nice bearings and they're quiet, but I started with some inexpensive bearings from Amazon, and this is a comparison of the ease of travel of the two bearings. Likewise, this is a comparison of an inexpensive 12mm shaft to a quality 12mm shaft. Same bearing. We start with nice clean mechanics, and then we add a bunch of cables. These are industrial shielded Ethernet cables, and in the end I use standard Ethernet cables to improve the bend radius and to make movement easier. The inductive sensors are small and have a fraction of a millimeter clearance requirement, but compared to the electromechanical switches I was using before, I feel that the inductive switches are going to last much longer. It's hard to believe, but this is the only video I could find of the XY stage moving. I'm working on an improved, simpler design, and with that one, I'll be sure to get additional video. Okay, thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please let me know. I'd be glad to answer them. And until the next video, take care.